Good morning. Welcome to our service as we celebrate Easter together. My name is Mark Fraser. I'm the vicar of St. Luke's and Edwalton, and I'm here with Catherine and the rest of the family, and we're going to be leading this service and also trying to include some other people in the service, so look out for that later. Welcome if you're regularly worship at St. Luke's. Welcome if you regularly worship at the Church of the Holy Rood in Edwalton. And welcome if you worship somewhere else or don't usually worship anywhere. You're very welcome to join with us as we celebrate the good news of Easter. You may need, as you go through the service, it'd be great if you've got some bread and wine to hand. We'll be using that later to help us remember and look forward to all that Jesus has won for us through the Easter story. You may also want to have a Bible open so you can follow along with the readings. We're hoping that we'll have the words of some wonderful Easter hymns for you, but they'll be on the screen.
As we come to Easter this morning, I'm sure we're all thinking of lots of different things and feeling a lot of different things. This is not necessarily the Easter we hoped for. It's not a normal Easter. Perhaps our family Easter traditions have been interrupted. Perhaps a planned holiday has had to be postponed, or perhaps we're just fed up with being in lockdown. Perhaps you're a key worker, or your mum and dad are, you're exhausted and haven't actually seen much of your family at all. On the first Easter day, some of the disciples were still in shock and grief.
On the first Easter day, some of the disciples were confused and afraid.
On the first Easter day, some of the disciples were despairing and without hope.
On the first Easter day, some of the disciples felt a glimmer of possibility.
On the first Easter day, some of the disciples met a familiar stranger.
On the first Easter day, some of the disciples could scarcely believe their eyes.
On the first Easter day, some of the disciples met with the risen Jesus.
However you're feeling this morning, however heavy or light your heart feels, this is the truth that we have received.
This reading is from Acts 10, verse 36 to 43. You know the message God sent to the people of Israel, announcing the good news of peace through Jesus Christ, who is Lord of all. You know what has happened throughout the province of Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John preached. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power, and how he went around doing good and healing all who were under the power of the devil, because God was with him. We are witnesses of everything he did in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They killed him by hanging him on a cross, but God raised him from the dead on the third day and caused him to be seen. He was not seen by all the people, but by witnesses whom God had already chosen, by us who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one whom God appointed as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name.
I'm sure you're familiar with the Easter responses. This is the truth. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Well, I hope your neighbours have heard that Easter affirmation this morning. And perhaps you might want to open your windows as we sing with joy these two wonderful hymns of Easter, a traditional one and a more modern one, as we celebrate the truth of Easter together.
Thank Jesus Christ, my living hope. on me. He has broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my Savior. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, He sets me free. Hallelujah. As lost its grip on me, He has broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my Savior. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no name on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Jesus Christ is the victory. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, He set me free. Hallelujah. Sin has lost its grip on me.
A special prayer for Easter morning. God of glory, by the raising of your Son, you've broken the chains of death and hell. Fill your church with faith and hope, for a new day has dawned and the way to life stands open in our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, now's the time to come where we're going to hope to catch up with some different members of our church family and ask them how they've been getting on through this Easter season. What's been different about them? What's been challenging? And what's been encouraging? So I don't really want to catch up with Joel and Cam and Millie for now. So we'll take them out. So as you can see, we've got the Vandermarks, we've got David and Stuart there, and we've also got Sarah Hewitt. So first of all, I'm going to come to the Vandermarks, and we'll put Sarah back in a moment. So Stuart, tell us a little bit about how this journey to Easter has been for you.
There you go. I thought you were going to forget to give a sound, Mark. It's been certainly different this year. Work's been obviously a big stress. We've had to get 200 people working remotely and out of the office, except a few people for tasks that we need. And we've had to kind of work out how to keep the business going, where there's an economic collapse all around us. Everyone's got to work really differently. What's been exciting in that is seeing the way that people have really tried to find new ways to communicate and to keep their team going and to keep community, a sense of community going, both in work and in other areas as well, which has been really, really encouraging.
Yeah. And that's right. It's just, you've had to find new ways of working as a business, just like we've had to find new ways of connecting as church. Is it a similar thing?
Oh, absolutely. And like church, you know, we've discovered Zoom and been using different technology to keep up with people and to speak to clients. So, yeah, we've been doing exactly the same things. We've picked up a few tips from the church. So it's been quite useful. And this is a new technology to me as well. So we might use this one in the future.
Excellent. Yes. And David, good to see you. How's it been? It's a very different Easter for you two. What's been hard about it and what's been really good about it?
The thing what's good about it is that I can talk to my friends on Zoom, like my dad said, and you can keep in touch with them in different ways as well. Yeah. And the thing what is different is that you can, that your friends is like far away from you. Like normally I'd go to my friend's house and now you can't.
Yeah, and that's difficult, isn't it? Yeah, that's hard. And I guess many of us listening will say, yeah, I feel like that too. I found it really hard not being able to connect with my friends too. But David, I know that you've been working on something for Easter, haven't you? You've been getting something ready. Could you show us what you've been working on and preparing?
Yeah. Do you want to give us 20 seconds to get into position?
Yeah, you go, off you go. We look forward to seeing this.
Oh, look, the outside. So, Dave, explain what we've got.
So here we've got a palm leaf with Hosanna and love. Hosanna is full because when Jesus came in, people shouted Hosanna. Love's full because Jesus loved us. Yeah.
Next one, quickly.
This one's hope because we've got a rainbow because hope's because rainbow means hope. Yeah. And cross because Jesus died on the cross. And so he loves us.
Yeah.
And then the team because Jesus rose again.
Brilliant. Hey, thanks for showing us. I know you've been working on that and you've been wanting to keep it, especially for Easter Day. So thanks for showing us all your hard work and reminding not just us, but everyone on your street of the story of Easter and what it means. Brilliant. Well, I hope you enjoy the rest of the service, guys. And we're going to catch up with Sarah now. So it's been great seeing you, and have a very happy Easter. And we'll hopefully all meet again soon.
I look forward to seeing you. See you soon, everybody.
Bye.
Great. And now we've got Sarah. Hi, how are you?
Hi, how are you?
Well, I'm all the better seeing that window display. How epic was that?
Fantastic, good. Now, same question to you, Sarah, during different Easter. What's been challenging and what's been encouraging for you? You might just...
Lots of challenging things. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, I can hear you now. That's fine, yeah.
Okay. Lots of challenging things in that work has been quite difficult to start with and then... has pretty much dropped away completely. So I'm now down to one day a week of work, which is quite difficult, but also handy because it means I'm around for the children, which is lovely. And I'm now enjoying having this time with them and all this time to do things that we wouldn't normally do together. So that's amazing. Mood-wise, like lots of people, I've been up and down different days. I feel different things. Can't work out what's going on or how I can contribute, or I'm used to doing things and I found it really hard, feeling quite helpless. But good things have been staying really connected to my house group. Lydia and I have continued to run Bible studies, small ones for the group over Zoom, and we're all just checking in with each other on the WhatsApp group. I know lots of them are rallying around, helping each other out with shopping and bits and bobs. So it's just been lovely to stay connected to my house group and have their support and friendship.
Yeah. Great. That's really good to hear. Yeah. And yet, I think when we were talking the other day, you were saying actually how particularly at the beginning of this period, you found it really difficult to kind of connect with God and to sort of experience his presence.
Yeah, I think the first week felt a bit surreal, and I felt very disconnected to God and was searching a lot for a way to feel close to him. And it was really hard, but the way I got through that was just using all of this time I suddenly had and using more of it to read the Bible, pray, and just take some time to sit at God's feet really and listen. And since then it's been great. I'm much more connected and I'm feeling him with me through this, definitely.
Brilliant. That's really good to hear, and I'm sure many other people have found that this strange and unusual time, it had an effect on them in so many different ways, and probably including their relationship with God. I'm sure it raises all sorts of questions for people, but but thank you for sharing some of your story and how through doing the things you always do and being consistent, you know, God drew close again, as his promise. When we draw close to God, his promise is that he will draw close to us. So that's thank you for sharing. We hope that you and your family have a happy Easter and enjoy the rest of the day, and you enjoy the rest of the service. And we're going to move on.
Can
to something.
Can I just say hello to everyone? Can I just say hello to everyone? And I'm missing you all so much. I wish I could see your faces too.
You too.
Okay. Bye, Sarah. Great to catch up. We're going to do now, I know that many of you have been busy over the Easter period, and I've got some photographs, not been able to get all of them, but we're going to show you a few photographs of some of the things that you've been doing. I know that some of you have been making Easter gardens, some of you have been making Easter cards to send to Hilton Grange. The Elevate group have been doing that along with some others, and I've just got some pictures to show you. If I haven't got your picture, I'm really sorry. But hopefully you might be there. If you've done things we haven't seen yet, you could send them in to Sarah, and we'll find ways of making them available, perhaps through the Facebook page. So here we've got some Easter gardens. I wonder if you haven't had a go of making an Easter garden. There's some beautiful ones there. And here we've got some of the cards, Easter cards and Easter messages. Wonderful pictures of hope and of the rainbow there. And an Easter card here. And our very own David Pilkington, who picks up the cards. It was all the handover was all done in a socially distanced fashion, and the cards were taken, and then David has delivered them around Hilton Grange. And I know I've spoken to, so I've got some of the people in my parcel cell live in Hilton Grange, and they were really encouraged to receive these cards, these messages of hope and messages of joy. We now come to our part in the service where we hear the story of the first Easter morning according to John's Gospel.
Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They've taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they've put him." So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. He saw and believed. They still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to where they were staying. Now Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she began to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white, seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They have taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they have put him." At this, she turned round and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. He asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it you are looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned towards him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said these things to her.
The first thing that struck me about Easter this year is its hiddenness, its mystery. We often explode into Easter Sunday as if it's all obvious, as if the joy of Easter Sunday has immediately obliterated all the tears, the pain and the sorrow of Good Friday, as if all is immediately well with the world just like that. But on the first Easter, the greatest day in history, the most significant event that's ever happened takes place without anybody knowing. Just as when Jesus died, the skies turned black, as if God wanted to hide the suffering of his son from the world, so his resurrection takes place without anyone realizing. In the stillness and silence of that first day of the week, at some point, his heart begins to beat. Blood begins to course through his veins. His lungs begin to inflate. And Jesus is raised from the dead. If you want to be excited about this reality, then please search on YouTube for a song by Andrew Peterson called "His Heart Beats" from his amazing album Resurrection Letters. It's an incredible song that captures the wonder of that amazing moment. Now, if you were at our carol service this year, you might remember, either St. Luke's or Edwalton, you might remember these swaddling bands with which Jesus was wrapped when he entered the world as a baby in Bethlehem. Of course, in death, he was wrapped once more, wrapped and bound. But now, as the disciples look into the tomb, these grave clothes lie carefully folded and ordered on the place where his body had been. It's a detail that the gospel writers focus on the account. Three times they tell us about the grave clothes. It must have had such an impact on Peter and John and Mary on that first morning. Well, an impact on John anyway. We read that he saw and believed. It wasn't yet a fully formed faith. It wasn't yet a deep understanding, not yet a working through of all that has happened and all that it meant and how it relates to the scriptures he knew so well. But Peter is not mentioned yet as believing. Perhaps he's still wound up in his grief and shame. And Mary, well, she's still weeping. She's still looking for the body of her dead friend. If Easter feels particularly important this year, as we live in this new strangeness, where life seems on hold for so many of us, where life and death is at the forefront of our minds, where we're fearful and maybe anxious, and yet also encouraged by signs of goodness and compassion. If our Easter remembrances and celebrations are to be relevant and really joy-giving, then they also need to be real. And they need to be true to the first Easter and true to our experience today, not just trite or simplistically triumphant. I think the first Easter tells us that real Easter faith grows through tears. It doesn't take them away. Mary cries at the empty tomb, and I'm sure she'll shed tears again, perhaps at the Ascension when Jesus goes from their sight to return to the Father. The early church will have tears amidst its suffering and persecution. You see, Easter doesn't inoculate Christians against hardship and sorrow. It doesn't take sadness or sickness or death away, but it does transform them. We still grieve, but now we grieve as people with hope. Perhaps you're struggling this morning. Perhaps you feel like Mary. You may have known some tears. And Easter hasn't taken your tears away. But the promise is that Easter will transform them. Because of Easter, you can know the risen Jesus stands beside you as he stood beside Mary, even while she wept. The second thing Easter tells us is that real Easter faith grows through our fears. Easter doesn't necessarily take all our fears away. On this evening, the disciples will meet behind locked doors because they're fearful of the Jews. And then a week later, even once they've seen Jesus, they're still behind locked doors, still afraid. When I was taken in the ambulance, struggling to breathe, I was afraid. Easter doesn't inoculate Christians against fear and worry, but it does transform them. I remember Tim Parker, our curate, perhaps you do, telling us that courage isn't about not feeling afraid. Courage is about feeling fear and stepping forward anyway. How can we take courage? Well, remember the risen Jesus, who in our fears stands alongside us and says, "Take heart, I've overcome the world." Easter faith also grows amidst our sneers. Well, that's not a great word, but it's the best word I could find for doubt that rhymes. There's so much to take in. It's natural to have questions all through our Christian lives. Things we don't understand, things we can't make sense of. Thomas, one of Jesus' disciples, clearly struggles to make sense of this Jesus who's here and then gone again. And then there's the disciples, they don't recognize Jesus, and then they do, and it's different and yet the same. There's so much to take in, so many questions. And there's a long history of God's people believing and trusting and yet doubting and struggling all together. Look at the Psalms as they express fear and doubt and yet an ongoing trust. If you haven't watched the film The Two Popes, I really recommend it to you. Fantastic film. At times it's humorous, at times it's profound, it's often deeply moving. And it tells the story of Pope Benedict and Pope Francis. And through their lives, we see times of tears, times of failure, times of fear, times of doubt even. And yet we see something of their wrestling with faith and they're continuing to walk in the footsteps of Jesus. Well, there's one more I've got. I wonder if you could imagine one more word that rhymes with sneers. or fears or tears. Finally, I think Easter faith grows through the years. Easter is not just a day, it's a whole season. The church sets aside 6 whole weeks to allow the truth of Easter to sink in. And that's only for starters. It's only as we decide to walk with the risen Jesus over the long haul that the overwhelming, life-transforming truth of Easter begins to sink in. I think it will take until eternity for it to truly sink in. Easter doesn't take away our tears, our fears, our sneers of doubt, but it does transform them. Now, I don't know about you, but I like dingbats. And I've tried to make a dingbat for you this morning. I wonder if you know dingbats, they're a picture that tries to capture a phrase. So I wonder if you can work out what this dingbat might represent. You might want to use the comments. I'm gonna wait and see what ideas people come up with. Did you know? I'll check with my family, see if they know what it is. Yeah. Have you got an idea?
No idea.
Not yet, no.
You don't know what it is? I like that one. Stop your tears. That's a good one. It's not quite that. I think I produced it in a different software, and I think it was a bit clearer there. So if it's too challenging and if I've done a really rubbish dingbat, I apologize. Because of Easter, death, doubt and fear are not a full stop. This is meant to be a white for empty and a blue for a full stop. Because of Easter, death are not a full stop. They're not the end of the story. Because of Easter, they've been turned from a full stop to an ellipsis. Now, if you see the sign of the 3 dots on your computer, perhaps on Facebook or a web browser, what does it mean? When you see 3 dots like this on your Facebook browser, on your computer, what does it mean? Well, on my computer browser, I know that if I click not finished yet, thank you, Sarah. Sarah's on the ball. Yeah, there's more to come. If you click on the 3 dots on my browser, a whole range of menu options opens up. Possibilities become available. Easter may not take our tears or our fears or our doubts away. But Easter says they're not the end. There's now so much more. But Easter has taken something away forever. Because of Easter, sin and death no longer have the power to separate us from God. Now Mary can know Jesus in her tears. Peter can know Jesus removing his guilt and shame. Thomas can know Jesus beside him in his doubts. And Stephen, the first Christian martyr, at the moment of his death, can see heaven open and his eternal future open up before him. Because of Easter, we have the risen Jesus with us now, sometimes hidden, but always here. Because of Easter, we have a future hope that sustains us through the difficult times. because we know that one day in his presence, when his kingdom comes in all his fullness, when he returns again, all tears and fears and sneers will be wiped away once and for all. And that is worth celebrating. Hallelujah. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Now we're going to take some time to pray, and Catherine's going to lead us in our prayers.
We're going to use some simple arm actions, hand actions, if you want to join in. And we're using pray letters that we've used quite often before. And we've already paused, haven't we? And this is my pause. It's two stripes and the button that we press to pause. So we've paused and thought about God and who he is. And we've rejoiced, my arms have gone off the screen because my arms are up in the air, and we've rejoiced and praised him for what he's done. And now we're coming to ask, we're coming to say, please, please, please. So if you can hold your hands like this, and we're going to start by asking God for ourselves. And the things we want, and we can be honest with God about the things we find difficult, about the help that we'd like, of what we'd like to see, and we can share our heart with him. But also we know that he is God and he can say no. And when we ask our parents sometimes and say, please can I have this, sometimes the answer is no, and that's okay. So we're coming to God honestly, we're going to tell him honestly what we feel. But also we're going to trust him because he knows what we really need. So what I'm going to suggest is some of you might like to type in your prayers. Others of you might like to just say them out loud where you are. Maybe your family will hear you if they're with you, or maybe just God will hear you. And we're going to do that here. We're just going to say a few prayers all at the same time. God can work it out. And first of all, we're just going to pray for ourselves and how we tell God how we feel. Lord God, I feel really tired at the moment. Mm-hmm. And I ask that you would help me to know what things I should be doing and how I can serve you. In this way, in this place. Amen. And now we're going to move our arms out a little bit, and we're going to pray and say please for people that we know, and situations that were around us and close to us. So we'd really like to pray for Dud Mees and for Sue Morris at the moment. And pray that God will be with them, and his healing hand will be with them, and say, share what we want for him. Also, it might also be for our neighbours, for those we know who are working as key workers in the hospitals, in the supermarkets, in different places. So let's pray. Lord God, I just really want to pray for Dad.
Right, pray for Dad.
And the whole family. Don't worry.
Healing and strength.
And I pray for
recovery. Pray for all those sadness and things and struggle in different ways in the Lord. Asking you to healing and healing. Not there will be moments in short on this Easter day. Particularly when you feel isolated and struggling to connect. But there'll be ways in which others will
communicate
with something of your Easter.
Thank you. Amen. And now we're going to stretch our arms out even further, and we're going to pray for parts of the world and other parts of the world that are also struggling. And you will have, I'm sure, things that you know about. I'd really like to pray for those vulnerable countries where coronavirus is perhaps just arriving, and they don't have the resources that they need. In Sierra Leone, they have one ventilator for 7.5 million people. In Yemen, half the hospitals are closed because of war. Venezuela has no resources at all after lots of different policies and things that have gone on there. And let's just pray for some of these places that we know are will really struggle so much more than we are here. Amen. And now we're going to come to our why, which is yield. So we're just going to lift our arms up and we're going to recognize that God is in control and surrender these prayers to him. I'll just pray for this bit. Lord God, we've told you our hearts, we've shared our hearts with you. And we want to say, just as Jesus did in Gethsemane, not our will, but your will, Lord. Mm-hmm. We trust you. Mm-hmm. We trust your kingship. And we trust that you are in control. And we give all of these things we've been praying about. We bring them to you. Mm-hmm. And we trust you with them. Amen.
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 And then let's just finish by saying the Lord's Prayer together. It's going to come up on the screen to help us. There. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
We're now going to sing that wonderful hymn, Forever He's Glorified. The moon and stars, they wept. John and Cam are going to lead us and we worship our risen Lord.
Perfect love could not be overcome.
death is your sting, how resurrected grief has rendered you defeated. Forever he is glorified, forever he is lifted high, forever he is risen. He is alive, he is alive. Crown to shame, stone was rolled away. His perfect love and love we overcome. Now death, where is your sting? Our resurrected king has rendered you defeated. Forever he is glorified, forever he is lifted high, forever he is risen. He is alive, he is alive.
We now come to that time in the service where you might want to take bread and wine if you have any where you are, and you might want to gather round it. If you're with other people now, you might want to gather round it, or if you're on your own too. You're not on your own in spirit. The risen Jesus is with you. His spirit is with you, and we are all together at this at this time. We may be in different places, but we're united by the Spirit of God who is present with us. We are still the body of Christ. Now, one of the hard things for Christians during this time of social distancing and isolation is that we can't celebrate communion. We can't eat from one bread and we can't share the one cup together in one place. However, the symbols of bread and wine continue to be incredibly powerful. We can use them wherever we are to remember with thanksgiving what Christ has done for us, and to look forward to the time when we shall all gather again, both in a few weeks or months' time, but also in his heavenly kingdom. Firstly, the bread and wine help us to look back and remember with thanksgiving. Just going to read some words that Paul wrote to the Corinthians as he reminded them of the story that he'd received of how Jesus had left the disciples with a way of remembering him. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23, Paul writes, "For I received from the Lord what I also pass on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" Take a moment right now to thank Jesus for the way that he's shown his love for us. So many different ways, but ultimately in that he loved us and gave his life for us. Take a moment to thank Jesus for all that he means to you personally. We want to take a couple of moments to pray with members of your family. Secondly, when we look at the bread, we are reminded that we are the body of Christ. We may be scattered and broken apart at the moment, but we're no less his body. Let's now take a moment to remember each other, to thank God for those who are perhaps with you now in your own home, or to thank God for your small group members or the pastoral cell members who've been encouraging you and supporting you over the last few days and weeks. Or perhaps take a moment to thank God for Christians who've been important to you in your journey of faith. It's a time to pray for people we haven't seen for a while, perhaps, or for people we know in our networks who are struggling, who perhaps feel a bit broken themselves. Thirdly, Jesus told us that the bread and wine are signs for us until he comes again. They point us to the future. We anticipate the time when we'll be back together, but also the time when Christ will come again, when we no longer need symbols like bread and wine, because we'll be living in the presence of the real thing. We will be with the resurrected Jesus. I'm going to pray a prayer. Almighty God, Father of all mercy, we, your servants, give you humble and heartfelt thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness. We bless you, for you made us, you sustain us, and you pour out your blessings upon us day after day. But most of all, we thank you for your immeasurable love in saving the world through your Son, our Lord Jesus. We thank you for the means by which we receive your grace and goodness, and for the glorious hope that we have in you. Give us, we pray, such a sense of all your mercies and kindnesses that our hearts may burst and overflow with thanksgiving. And help us to praise you not just in the words we say, but in the way we live our lives, serving you and others, and by walking in the way that you've set for us all our days. We pray through Jesus our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honour and glory for ever and ever. Amen. So now the moment's come. I encourage you, if you have bread and wine, to eat the bread and drink the wine in remembrance and with thanksgiving. You should see some words on the screen that we could say together at this time. We remember with thanks and look forward with expectation. So now is the time to eat and drink, to remember, to give thanks, to look forward. We choose to look back with thanksgiving. We choose to face this day with courage. And we choose to look forward with hope, for Christ is risen and with us by his Spirit. I'm going to sing our final song now, In Christ Alone.
My light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when strife is ceased, my comforter, my only hope, here in the love of Christ I stand. Christ alone, he took on flesh, fullness of God in boundless fame. This gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. To earn that cross as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin, him was made. Here in the death of Christ, I live. There in the ground, his body lay. The lies of the world by dark. Then resting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since Christ has lost his grip on me, for I am his and he is mine. All through the precious blood of Christ. Here to life, fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. Life's just cry to a final breath. My destiny, the power of hell must be my man, and ever knock me from his hand, till he returns, or calls me home. Here is the power of Christ, I stand, the power of hell must be my man. Ever
and as I stand in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me. For no power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. Reminds us of that phrase that we've been hanging on to as a church community over the last few weeks, that we are held in his grip, the grip of Christ risen from the dead. He has power over sin, over death, over the grave, and over life and life eternal. So there's nowhere that we go that we cannot be held securely by him. So now, as we come to the end of our service with that thought and those words ringing in our ears, hear and receive the blessing of God. God the Father, by whose glory Christ was raised from the dead, strengthen you to walk with him in his risen life. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you all and those you love now and always. Amen. So thank you for being with us for our Easter celebration. I pray that you will enjoy the rest of this day. You'll know the presence of Jesus with you. Joy of Easter flooding your hearts. And look forward to keeping in touch with you over the coming weeks, the services that will be coming up. Next week, we're going to be sharing details of lots of streams, lots of services, meetings, talks that you can connect with from Spring Harvest. Spring Harvest is making all its resources available for free, and we'll be communicating with you how you can connect with those. But for now, go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.